So, welcome to the lecture course, The Early Universe in the Winter Term 2021-22. So this is a specialized lecture course of 2 hours per week, following the main courses on Relativity and Cosmology, Part 1 and 2. You can see the recordings online of Relativity 1 and 2, and I recommend in particular have a look at chapter 12 in Relativity 2, where I give an introduction into cosmology. Now here the focus is on the early universe, and you will see what I mean with early, but basically it's the first 3 minutes. I mean, to cite Steven Weinberg's famous book from the 1970s, and in particular, even earlier than the first three than minutes, fractions of a second. So we will discuss in particular the inflationary universe, which is well, more or less generally accepted model for the origin of the structure formation in the universe. Now you find more details about the literature and so on our website, but let me here list the contents. So there are 2 parts. The first part is about the homogeneous isotropic universe, and the second part about perturbations around. So we have here the first part is the homogeneous isotropic universe, starting from a brief review of what I did in the last semester with the Friedmann-Lemaître equation. So we have here 3 parts. So the first talk about the expanding universe. The second is then already the early universe, the hot universe, the radiation dominated phase, so it's called the hot universe. And then I discuss inflation, part one, the homogeneous limit. So inflation means, okay, it's a concept comes from economics, but it means here that we have a phase of the universe that expands exponentially or quasi-exponentially, around 10 to the minus 34 or so seconds after the Big Bang. Then, of course, this is homogeneous isotropic, so we would not be there if the universe were exactly homogeneous. So we have to treat structure, and this structure in the universe came out of primordial fluctuations. So we have to discuss in the part 2 the inhomogeneous universe. And so this is consists of 4 parts. So these are the chapters 4, 5, 6, and 7. And of course we have to discuss gravitational instability. I mean, structure in the universe comes from the fact that gravity is universally attractive. So even if you have an almost homogeneous state, so structure formed by matter clumping. And we first discussed this in Newtonian theory, gravitational instability in Newtonian theory. Proceeding then to general relativity, so in general relativity, that's the relevant theory, of course, as you know. And then I go back to inflation and discuss perturbations, and actually there we see the origin of the primordial inhomogeneity. So this is chapter 6, and it's called Inflation 2 and the origin of primordial inhomogeneities. Actually, these are quantum perturbations. So all the structure in the universe, according to this scenario, all the galaxies and clusters of galaxies, they emerge from quantum fluctuations. And finally, we discuss, I mean, the cosmic microwave background. Background anisotropies. And this is the connection to observation. I mean, of course, we can do many calculations as much as we want, but I mean, at the end, we have to compare with observations, and we observed these primordial inhomogeneities here. So that's the program for the next coming months until end of January, beginning of February. And let me start now with here the first part, homogeneous isotropic universe, and the first chapter. So let me directly go here. So one is the expanding universe. So as I said in this first lecture today, I more or less repeat and summarize what we already did in the last course. So many things will look familiar to you. And for those of you who already feel sound in this topic from the last semester, could skip this first lecture and next week going to the second one. Now, we observe structures in the universe. And I should first explain the appropriate scale. Now, in physics, we use dimensions, I mean, like lengths, masses, and time scales. And what is the appropriate length scale here in cosmology? Of course, we can use meters. That's fine. But then, because the universe is big, we have to use large exponentials. So astronomers prefer to use another quantity called the parsec or megaparsec. So the appropriate scale is the megaparsec. MPC, so mega always means million. So 1 megaparsec is 10 to the 6 parsec and is around 3.09 times 10 to the 24 centimeters. Now, a parsec is a bit more than 3 light years, so that's also historic length scale. And it gives you the size of the Earth's sun distance. From a distance where it is just one arc second. But here in cosmology, it's the megaparsec, and we will see that the size of the observable universe is about a bit more, 1,000 or 10,000 as much as this. Now, up to, say, about 100 megaparsecs, we observe distinctive structures, and above, around 100 megaparsecs, we have just a repetition of these structures. No? So up to the order of 100 megaparsec. There's a dispute, of course, from the observational side here about this number, which I will not enter. And so we have galaxies, clusters of galaxies, and superclusters. So superclusters are clusters of clusters. But then we have a repetition. This is what I mean, that up to 100 megaparsecs you have this hierarchy, but beyond that you have just new superclusters. Up to some, I mean, delicacies and observations, there might be some superstructures, but that's not clear. And we have voids. Voids are more or less empty regions between those superclusters. So, and voids. And by now we have a lot of data from telescopes, from satellites and so on, and star catalogs and galaxy catalogs about this. Now let us have a look at our own galaxy, which is the Milky Way. So we are inside one of those. So the structure looks a bit like that. Of course, it's a very dilettantic picture. You can find nice pictures in the books and in the internet. But roughly, you have this disk and you have this bulge, yeah, so in the middle. So this is called a bulge. And so the size of this roughly is 30 kiloparsec. No, so compare the difference, no, with megaparsec, kiloparsec. And we are not in the middle, where we have had a lot of stars. So we are somewhat here. And so the size of this here, this is not to scale, of course. It's about 1 kiloparsec. And okay, we have to the center of the Milky Way, maybe around 20, well, somewhat less than 15 kiloparsec. So this here, I mean, the dimension here, this is around, say, 30 kiloparsec roughly. Of course, galaxies come with very different sizes. So this is just to have an idea. And the clusters of galaxies are 5 megaparsec, and the superclusters are about 50 megaparsec. Just to give an idea. I mean, don't take these numbers to as too precise values. Now, we are, as galaxy, belong to a cluster, and this cluster is called the local group. Yeah. So we belong to the local group, and if you have time, once you can just see in the internet, if you look for the local group, nice three-dimensional pictures where you find all these dozens of members. I mean, the Andromeda galaxy is the most famous one, our big neighbor, but there are also others and also very small galaxies. And this here is called the Virgo supercluster, because you see it in the direction of the constellation Virgo. Okay, this we know mainly from redshift surveys. And above this, we have a repetition of the structure. Now, one of the central tasks of cosmology is, of course, to provide an explanation for this structure. Yeah? Do we just have to take this as given and just describe it like in botany, in the books? Or do we want to really understand the origin? Of course, in physics, we want to understand the origin from our physical theories, which is general relativity. But as I will show you, we have to go very far back to understand the origin of it, and where we need something beyond relativity. At least we need quantum theory. Now, I should say something about the observable universe. I mean, we don't know how large the universe actually is. But the universe is finite in time, as you recall. So it has almost 14 billion years old. But that means, because information travels at a finite speed, that we can only receive information from a finite part of the universe. And this finite part, the size of it can be calculated, and we did it in the last semester by using the concept of a particle horizon, can be calculated, and this is what we call the visible, or maybe much better, it's observable universe, because we don't not only use optical information. So the observable universe this comes from the cosmic particle horizon, which we had in relativity, but I will perhaps say something about this also here later. Or we can make an estimate, because that's what basically it coincides, the so-called Hubble lengths. And if we forget about prefactors and all that. So the scale we have in a homogeneous universe, isotropically expanding universe, is one scale, and this is the Hubble length that comes from the Hubble parameter that gives the expansion rate. So Hubble length, we have the Hubble constant. H naught, which is defined as, I mean, from relativity, A dot is the scale factor, A dot over A, evaluated today. And I will give in the next section a review of the Friedmann-Lemaître equation. So you will encounter this again. So even if you have not heard it in the last semester, I will explain that. And this has dimension, as you see, 1 over time. So one can associate with that a time, which is the inverse, that's the Hubble time, or a length when you multiply it with the speed of light. So Hubble length is c times h naught to the minus 1. So it's a question, of course, what is the value of h naught? It's appropriate to use here a dimensionless parameter, small h. And then you can write it in this form. Okay, so this, of course, is a length, so it can be written in megaparsec. And this small h expresses the uncertainty that we have in this value. I mean, Hubble's law, if you recall, is something like, speed of light times the redshift is h naught times distance. So this is only an approximation for not too far structures, but you see from here the dimension of this, which is here kilometer per second over megaparsec. That's what the astronomers do. So we have here, so we can here write h naught is 100 times small h, and then kilometer per seconds. And megaparsec, and this small h is what occurs here. It's chosen in that way because observational h naught lies between roughly 50 and 100. So this small h is a number between 1/2 and 1, and that's convenient. Now, this here, okay, we can also write this instead of megaparsec with gigaparsec, so this is 3 h to the minus 1. Gigaparsec. And gigaparsec is the basic the scale for the entire observable universe. Now, what's the value of h naught? This is a story by itself, and I could give a whole hour just telling you about the history of h naught, which is fascinating, but it's not really the topic of this lecture. So, there was a satellite, it's no longer operating, Planck. We will learn later about it. About 10 years ago, was a mission to observe the cosmic microwave background. And from cosmic data, you could also infer a value of h naught. And the last data, so the final data analysis, was published in 2018. And they give the following value. So they give h naught is 67. 0.66 plus or minus 0.42 kilometer per second and megaparsec. So you see here, when we do estimates, I mean, we are here in a theory course, so when we do estimates, then I can roughly use this number and have the small h of around 2/3. Now this you can easily remember if you want to make a quick estimate of sizes. So so for our theory purpose, we can just take small h about 2/3. I should not hide to you a problem, which is called the Hubble tension. I mean, this is the value you get from CMB measurements, so really the cosmic measurements. But you can also observe, or you can measure the Hubble constant by independent means. by looking for variable stars in the supercluster and looking for supernovae and all that. So this is, at least in the cosmic scale, a bit more local. And the surprising thing is that we get a different value, a somewhat different value, but people claim that it's statistically significant. So we have this Hubble tension. So we get somewhat bigger values from non-cosmological measurements. So somewhat bigger values for H naught from more local observations. As I said, more local means the clusters and not the whole universe. And so this here, for example, you find various values, but one relatively recent value from the Hubble Space Telescope, observations by the Hubble Space Telescope, and a satellite called Gaia, which is doing astrometry. And they announced in 2020 the following value, that H naught is 72.1 plus or minus 2.0 kilometers per second and megaparsec. Right. So you see here 72 versus 67. So you might say, well, that's still of the same order. This is certainly true, but in experimental physics, we have to discuss, the errors precisely, and the experts claim, if you look at the error, that it is meant various sigmas discrepancy. So there is a problem, and there are many suggestions for solutions, but I will not enter this here, because now for our discussion of the early universe, this is not directly relevant, but you should keep this in mind. I should also say that, I did say, but I should write it down, that you also have the Hubble time here. Hubble time, let's call it TH naught. So this is defined as H naught to the minus 1, and you can write it as 9.78 small h to the minus 1 giga years. So you get around 14.4 giga years for h around 0.68. So you see the Hubble time is around this, and actually the order of magnitude corresponds to the age of the universe, as I have explained to you in the last semester. And so roughly 14, 13 giga years. Here perhaps I should have added also, how many masses you have. So our Milky Way, so that's the Milky Way. I should also write that down, Milky Way here. And this has a mass of around 1.4 times 10 to the 11 solar masses. No? So this is the mass of the Sun, and in astronomy we relate many masses to the solar mass, 10 to the 11, and we observe in the observable universe about 10 to the 11 galaxies. And so you have 10 to the 11 solar masses in this, and what we observe here is 10 to the 11 galaxies. So 10 to the 11 also corresponds roughly to the number of neurons in your brains. So you see the number of neurons in your brain corresponds to the number of roughly the stars in the Milky Way. Now, I mentioned the voids, and in fact, the volume filled by the galaxies is only about a millionth of the total volume. So we could, or this is what we do, we treat the galaxies as points in cosmology. Now you might say, okay, this is absolutely crazy, a galaxy is point, but you must keep in mind that in physics we always have to do idealizations, and these are different in cosmology than it is in the laboratory. So the cosmology is the universe is very big, and we envisage a more or less uniform distribution of matter, so various galaxies can be treated as points. So that corresponds to the visible matter. In addition, we also have the dark matter, which I will only briefly mention here. So dark matter is something that you can observe indirectly by its gravitational attraction on visible things. And visible also means by radio waves and so on. And we do not know what its origin. More precisely, there's a part of the dark matter is just maybe some invisible dust clouds. But we know that a bigger part thus cannot consist of what we call baryonic matter, consisting of protons and neurons, but must consist of exotic matter. And actually, we do not know what it is so far. And there's a very active field of research to understand dark matter. Now, so we here have the baryonic part. So this is, in a sense, stand-up matter that you do not see directly, but you feel or you can see its gravitational influence. But there's also a non-baryonic part. And that it's non-baryonic, we infer indirectly from the physics of the early universe. Now, that how do you know? I mean, that so maybe the most impressive way is to look for so-called rotation curves of galaxies. So, if you observe a galaxy, and we can observe the radial velocity of objects from the Doppler effect, and what we observe is something like this. So this is the distance from the center. And now the visible extension, say, of a galaxy, so this holds for many galaxies that we observe, is, say, up to here. Yeah, so this is the visible extension. That is, you don't see stars and here anymore. Okay, you may ask where you know that. This is from gas clouds and from hyperfine structures that you can observe. I mean the Doppler effect. But if there were only this visible matter, then you would expect that basically, because this is the gas clouds are not much, that basically this would go down here, like what is predicted from Kepler's law. So so this would be without dark matter. It would just be proportional r to the minus 1. No, so if all if matter were only in stars, so if matter were only in stars, then we would have this here proportional to r to the minus 1/2 outside the visible part. Yeah, minus 1/2 visible part. So that's here from Kepler's law. And so because we have V is g m over r to the 1/2, as you know already from Newtonian geometry. But in fact here, we have to here write m of r, because here we already also have mass here. Now, if there were no mass here, or the basis of mass here, then it would be the total m. You would have r to the minus 1/2. But you can write it in this way, and basically it's constant, roughly, which means that m of r more or less is proportional to r. So what is this dark matter? Big puzzle. So here this done. So we don't know yet. Maybe supersymmetric particles or other exotic particles we don't know. Yeah, this was already noticed quite early by a Swiss astronomer working in the United States. But as often with people who do something for the first time or notice something for the first time, it was not really taken seriously. Only later, and especially Vera Rubin in the United States, astronomer, so she from the 1970s on very precisely made measurements of this, and it was clearly then seen that there is something that, I mean, what Vicky found early was correct. Yeah. So, I mean, the cosmic microwave background, I briefly discussed in the last semester, so this is something, maybe I should at least for completeness have it here. So the cosmic microwave background, CMB, I mean, it's a historic name because it was first observed in the 1960s in the microwave regime, but it has a thermal distribution, so it's about all on all wavelengths that you see, and it's the most perfect Planckian or thermal curve that you can observe in nature. This is highly isotropic, but has small anisotropies. Of the order, well, roughly 10 to the minus 5. And actually, these anisotropies, they serve then, or they are a manifestation of the primordial fluctuations out of which structure in the universe emerges. An important principle that we used in cosmology is the cosmological principle. And without the cosmological principle, you can actually not go very far, and let me briefly review what is the cosmological principle. This dates back to Einstein of his first paper of 1917, the pioneering paper of cosmology, and in another paper of 1931, he expressed it in the following way, so in the original German, it says, alle Stellen des Universums sind gleichwertig. Im Speziellen soll also auch die örtlich gemittelte Dichte der Materie überall gleich sein, which means all places in the universe are alike. So all places in the universe are alike. So you have the average density of the matter is the same in all places. Of course, it's a principle that can be wrong, but observationally, there are indications of that. And I should also say in 1917, Einstein still believed that the universe is static because at that time it was hard to imagine that the universe evolved in time. So he also had another principle at that time that said, that also that the space structure and density is also constant in time. Now, the word cosmological principle came from the astrophysicist Edward Milne of 1933, and if you also apply this to time, then it's called the perfect cosmological principle, which was revived historically in the so-called steady state theory of the 1940s and 50s by Bondi, Gold, and others, which is no longer really used today. So that's the cosmological principle. I should also mention, sometimes you read about a Copernican principle, which is what was coined by Bondi in 1960. Now, the Copernican principle is somewhat different. The Copernican principle states, we are not at the center of the universe. No, like in Copernicus, since the sun is at the center of the universe, but not the Earth. Now, there are two words here. First is the we, and the second is the center. So this does not refer to us, of course, and to our place. But if you say we are not at the center of the universe, that would imply that there is a center, but we are not there. like in the Earth circling around the Sun. So that seems misleading, and most cosmologists these days only use the cosmological principle, and not the Copernican principle. Now, what are the consequences? Now, we have from the observation, we observe isotropy around our point of observation, around our vantage point, if you like, and you have this from the CMB, but also from the distribution of radio galaxies and quasars with roughly, you see the same number in any direction. Now, if you have this principle, then you should imply this is not a special case. So it would mean that the CMB is isotropic around every point, and the universe is isotropic around every point. So here, then we have isotropy about every point, around every point. And then we can use a mathematical theorem, and I exploited this in the last semester, actually a theorem by Schur of 1886, that from this we get homogeneity. So you see, observational input, cause a principle, and mathematics. So you have both. This is what physics is: observation, physical assumptions, and mathematical proof. And so we assume that we have roughly a three-dimensional universe, which is the universe at a given time, is roughly isotropic and homogeneous. Now, mathematically, this leads to so-called spaces of constant curvature. This spaces of constant curvature. If you do this geometrically, then a homogeneous space leads you to the space of constant curvature. So, which means for a three-dimensional space, we have the three-dimensional Ricci tensor, RIKLN. You can write as just a number times a combination of Kronecker symbols. So if you have this form, it corresponds to constant curvature. I mean, this here reflects the symmetry and antisymmetry properties of the Riemann tensor, and this is then just a number. And we have discussed this in more detail in relativity 2. And also what we discussed there is an important property of a space of constant curvature, namely it's conformally flat. Conformally flat means that the metric is up to a positive factor that can depend on x and does depend on x equal to the flat metric. So every space of constant curvature is conformally flat. So I should just to remind you, so two metrics are conformal to each other. The two metrics are related as follows. So this is in general not given by a coordinate transformation. They are really different geometries. And so the metric GAB and another metric, they're related here by such a local function. And conformally flat means that here, you have the eta metric. Now the three-dimensional line element we could write as follows then, a three-dimensional line element as a dl squared. which is there's a factor a squared, and then we could write it as follows using coordinates r and the angular coordinates, and I can here add this number r squared plus r squared the omega squared, where this number here k can be either a minus 1, 0 or plus 1, and here this d omega squared is d theta squared plus sine squared theta d phi squared, so that's the metric on the two-dimensional sphere with the standard meaning for the angles theta and phi, so the azimuthal and polar angle. A here is called the scale factor. Now here, as I wrote this down, R and of course the angle have no dimensions. Well, in spite of this name maybe suggesting a length, but it's not the case. So the length is here in A, and it because it gives that scale in cosmology, we call it a scale factor. So A is the scale factor, and we have also written A squared as a K over B is a 6K over the three-dimensional Ricci scalar, no? Which means that if K is negative, then this is also negative here. As I discussed in detail in relativity 2, I mean, we can give a nice geometric interpretation of the two values. So 0 just corresponds to a flat three-dimensional space, the R3. So plus 1 corresponds to a three-dimensional space that has the same geometry as the three-dimensional sphere. So it could be the sphere, but it could also topologically be something more complicated. And minus 1 would correspond to the geometry of the pseudosphere, which can also be topologically complicated, such as having versions similar to Klein bottles and whatever. So we don't know now about the topology of our universe. Einstein's equations only fix the local geometry, and the topology is something in addition, whether a future theory gives us constraints on topology is unknown, but so far it's just it's just an undetermined feature and must be determined from observations. But observations so far give no indications about a non-trivial topology. So topology will not be considered here further. Now this is space, so this three-dimensional line element of space. And we mean here with space the universe at a certain time. So we also then discussed in relativity how the line element of the four-dimensional space-time with this three-dimensional part looks like. And I mostly here really take the space-time dimensions, the number of them, to be four, because that's what we observe. Of course, there are speculations that we have maybe more dimensions that are not visible. And this is very relevant for many theoretical investigations. But for our purpose here, we discuss the early universe and partly from the observational point of view. And this is why we will stick to four here practically all the time. And so we call the four-dimensional line element S squared, which is minus d tau squared, where tau is the proper time. And this is then given by minus c squared dt squared plus a squared, and which now depends on t. So the universe, I mean, can expand or collapse and can behave dynamically. And then we have here the sum of a, b is 1 to 3. HAB of x1, x2, x3, dxA, dxB. And this is, apart from that scale, is a spatial metric. So that's the spatial metric so apart from the scale a squared of t. No? So in that here you see because of the symmetries, homogeneity, isotropy, this is fixed. No? This h a b, and the time dependence is just in the a squared. And this is what we mean with a b, in a sense the co-moving part of that. Now you already know that we mostly take units where c is equal to 1, so that we can measure both time and space in the same units, the units of length. So c is equal to 1, so we have minus et squared plus a squared of t hab. And if I use the sum convention also for the three dimensions, then we can write this in that form. Yeah. So note that as in the relativity class, we use the signature minus, plus, 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 which is now they used by most people, because here the spatial part is really positive definite, as we are used from school, yeah, that we measure this in meter squared and not in minus meter squared in Pythagoras. But the time is here with a different sign, minus dt squared. This is why I also had here the minus d tau squared if you use proper time. Now this here we call the Robertson-Walker line element. Robertson-Walker or RW line element. And if you use that here, no, so I should perhaps write it here again for completeness as a minus dt squared plus a squared of t dr squared 1 minus k r squared plus r squared d omega. That's the Robertson-Walker line element. That's our standard metric to work within the first part of the homogeneous universe. No? So we always have then here this metric with a time-dependent scale factor and of course the open parameter k. We have here is defined with respect to the cosmic microwave background. So the question arises from a more instrumental point of view, whether we can directly from this arrive at this line element. And to some extent we can, and I just want to cite two theorems. The first is the one by Ehlers, Girin and Sachs, the so-called EGS theorem, theorem of Ehlers, Girin and Sachs, EGS, who in 1968 proved the following. Let me first say it in words. If for a family of freely falling observers, so these are the co-moving observers that have no peculiar velocities, the CMB is everywhere exactly isotropic, space-time is described by the Robertson-Walker line element. And so just from taking this observation and having of course indirectly the cosmological principle, you can arrive at this. Of course in the proof something must be used, and because this is more general than here, the proof uses the Einstein equations, no, which we have not used so far. So if for a family of freely falling observers, the CMB is everywhere exactly isotropic. Well, it's not exactly isotropic, I will come to that, but if it were exactly isotropic, space-time is described bei die Robertson Walker Line Element. Ne? So I should emphasize here by writing it down, the proof uses Einstein's equations. Now, of course, it's not exactly isotropic, and the question arises what happens if we have small perturbations. And this was proven in 1995 that if we replace the word isotropic by almost isotropic, it remains true. No? So, Stöger, Martens, and George Ellis. In 1995, they proved that a theorem remains true if isotropic is replaced by almost isotropic. That it was proven in 1995 is not surprising, because in 1992 really the anisotropies were discovered, and we knew that it's from the, or we know from then that it's isotropic only to one part in 10 to the 5. So if that theorem would fail for small perturbations, then it would be of no use. So this means that this line element here can be applied approximately at least since the decoupling of radiation from matter, because that's where the CMB arises from. And that theorem then says that at least back to that time we can use that. Whether it's valid earlier on is more speculative. Now, we have seen in the lecture course of last semester that we can use other coordinates also for this part. And let me write one important coordinate, so the Robertson-Walker line element can also be written in this form: ds squared is minus dt squared plus a squared of t. Then instead of this here, we can use three angle type coordinates, d chi squared plus f squared of chi, but it is the same d omega squared as before, but this f squared can assume three possibilities. So either the sine squared chi if curvature is positive, the hyperbolic sine squared if curvature is negative, or just chi squared if the curvature is zero. No? So that's also something sometimes very convenient to use. And I should mention, of course, you can also mention different time coordinates. For example, later we will use so-called conformal time also. This t is distinguished. Of course, in full general relativity, all coordinates are equal in a sense. But here we have particular symmetries. We have this homogeneous space that is expanding. And for a co-moving observer who has always the same coordinates, I mean, this is zero, and for this observer, t corresponds to the proper time, tau, that this observer sees on a co-moving watch or clock. No? So that's the, so t is also called the Friedmann time, and it's the proper time for a co-moving observer. And in this sense, it's distinguished. Now, I should note here, just as a side remark, that there are inhomogeneous generalizations of this metric that you can try to use for, say, describing also the galaxies and so on as inhomogeneous structures. So this is just a note. So there are inhomogeneous generalizations of the Robertson-Walker metric. And maybe the most important one is the so-called Lemaître-Tolman-Bondy metric, e.g. the LTB model. So this stands for Lemaître-Tolman-Bondy. Basically going back to Lemaître's work of 1933, and so this metric has the form ds squared is a minus dt squared, but then you have here some other parts. Just let me write them down once. We actually will not need it in what we'll discuss later, but you see here then we have here a real function of r instead of just one scale factor. And okay, this e of r can assume also various value. So that's a metric that is actually spherically symmetric around a center. And the time of a big bang really depends on r. So because it's no longer homogeneous, you don't have one big bang. And the question is whether it can describe regions of the universe. So can it describe regions, or not the whole universe, but regions, the universe? Yeah. So that has this been tried? I mean, there's no consensus about that, but just to remark that people also use such metrics. Now, the final part of today, before we go on, just let me then now write down again for you the Einstein field equations, because we base our discussion on them, not on generalized theory of gravity. So we have here the Einstein field equations. R mu nu minus 1/2 g mu nu times r plus lambda g mu nu is 8 pi g times t mu nu, where this here is the Einstein tensor, capital G mu nu. So that's the form Einstein used in 1917 when he had introduced the cosmological constant lambda. Now, the modern point of view, as we will discuss also later, is to put this here on the right-hand side and to interpret this as a part of the matter, in a sense, the vacuum energy. A point that was already made by Schrödinger in 1918, very early, but which was not followed very much on then. So, we can write these equations, namely as g mu nu is 8 pi g t mu nu plus t mu nu that I call V. Vake stands for vacuum here, and this would then be the term minus lambda g mu nu over 8 pi g. So a positive lambda adds positively to t 0, 0. No? Recall we have minus plus 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 as the signature. No? So positive lambda adds positively to t 0, 0. Now, in fact, one can show that the Robertson-Walker metric enforces by the Einstein equations a certain form for t mu nu, because if the left-hand side has a certain symmetry, the right-hand side should also have the same symmetry. And it's actually the form that we call an ideal fluid. So this is why it is always used in homogeneous cosmology, because nothing else is allowed. So the Einstein or the Robertson-Walker metric enforces via Einstein's equations an ideal fluid fluid form for T mu nu, and this is given by the following expression, so T mu nu. So we have two functions of time, which is the density and the pressure. So we have here the density and the pressure. So you can interpret as mass density or energy density. Okay, the two differ by a C squared factor, which is here one. And then you have here u mu. So that's the velocity of a co-moving observer of the fluid, plus then the pressure P times g mu nu. So in a rest frame of this co-moving of the co-moving fluid, this would just look like that, rho p, and we have zeros here. So I mean only one pressure because of the isotropy. In general, you can have pressures differently in different direction, and you can also have here others, I mean fluxes and so on, and viscosities, but not in for the Robertson-Walker line element. Now, so that's the basis of the part one. So we have the Einstein field equations restricted to the Robertson-Walker line element with T mu nu given by the ideal fluid. And so next time I will discuss again or review, but also extend the discussion of the Friedmann-Lemaître equations, which follow from inserting the Robertson-Walker line element into this. So thank you for listening today, and I hope you will also be there next time. Bye-bye.